nationalism in India. Now, in the previous units, we have discussed about the nationalism struggles which have spread in Europe. Then we have shifted to the nationalism of Indo-national momentum with specific interest and focus on Vietnam. Now we shall move on to our own country, nationalism in India. How did the nationalism got its full-fledged momentum in India? So the topic is
nationalism in India.
The nationalism in India has been underlying current from 1850s onwards. In 1857, we have seen the revolt of the Sepoy Revolt, or the First War of Independence. The historians rightly remarked it as the First War of Independence because almost all the people have contributed to their efforts to show their dissatisfaction against the existing colonial rule. But somehow the Britishers managed to curb the moment and destroy the momentum during that time. So from that time onwards, we were not in a strong leadership to guide us to have a proper independent momentum or the rise of nationalism to its peaks. So let us discuss from the first phase of the 20th century, that is with the First World War. The period from 19th century onwards, I mean from 1901 to 20th century, 1901 to 1947, can be categorized into three major categories. So among that, the first phase, which was completely the moderate phase. So in the moderate phase, the Congress Party came into existence recently, newly during that period. It was only in 1885, they have the Congress Party stepping in up and forming a political organization to take the entire momentum under the streamline or under a single umbrella. To bring the entire nationalism into a single umbrella, Congress Party was the first initiative which has taken up or which has been formed with the only motto to fight against the Britishers. So in the initial years, the Congress restrained itself to go for petty and prey methods of appealing towards the Britishers. They always used to pray or appeal or write letters to the concerned authorities requesting them to grant certain concessions. That is the reason why it is known as the moderate phase, where it has been very soft towards the attitude of the Britishers, though we were facing a lot of difficulties. So after moving on from the moderate phase, the leaders started to change. The people were fed up with the soft nature of the Congress. The young generation leaders who are in the Congress itself turned up under the leadership, and they formed another group that is called the extremist group. The extremist group or the extremist phase of the Congress. In this extremist phase of Congress, they decided to go and fight, and they decided to go with the violent methods. This was a change of attitude of the leaders of the Congress movement. Now, what is the link between the Congress and the nationalism? As I told you before, the single-headed leadership is lacking for Indian movement of fight against Britishers. That is the reason why Britishers are able to defeat the Indians very easily, very comfortably, because we don't have a strong leadership during that time. And when the extremist phase started, the moderate phase, so when the change of the phase of the movement started, we need a strong leadership in the Congress also. But if you look at the around world during that time, the world has been witnessing World War I. The World War I started in 1914 and went on up to 1918. So, during this period, the Britishers were very much busy in the war and could not concentrate on what is happening actually in India. They were in a momentum or in an approach that India would support the Britishers to fight the war. So because of British participating in the war, the influence has been felt all over India also. Not only in India, the World War influence was felt all over the world, but India being a colonial country of Britishers, the impact was more. The Britishers were very busy in taking away the raw materials for their soldiers, and the war went on bringing loss to the people, and it created so much of loss because the entire agriculture changed or pattern, or the situations changed completely. Lack of rains resulted in the disaster in the agricultural sector. Many millions of people lost their livelihood, and many people from the villages are forced to join into the army in order to supply soldiers for the world war. So, and also this, but the war is something where the investment is kept, but you don't get back any returns. It is a business where there is no profit at all. So you are investing huge amount of investment on buying arms, putting up the arm race and all, and making the soldiers to go and fight there, and supplying everything for the soldiers. This all is a very huge business, and it costs so much, where the entire expenditure was drained off. Not only for Britain, for France, for Austria, for many countries, their income has been drained off. So in this process, from India also, many soldiers participated in the World War I, faced a lot of problems. And not only this, due to the severe famine and epidemics, nearly 12 to 13 million people lost their lives in India as per the census of 1921. So this is a momentum when India needs a very strong leader, a strong person who can hold the entire Indian nation and lead the leadership momentum, or take the momentum to a very large extent, take the nationalism spread to all corners of India. As you all know, in India, we have many languages, many cultures, many religions. So all people have to be brought under one umbrella, headed by one leader. Then only we can fight against the mighty Britishers. So during this period only, Mahatma Gandhi arrived from South Africa to India during 1915. Initially, when he came to India, he was warm welcomed by the Congress Party, because before he came to India, in South Africa, he fought against the same Britishers for the racial discrimination in South Africa, where he was made a national hero there. From then, he moved to India. But as soon as he stepped into India, he did not participate in politics. He went on to all the people all over India to find out what are the problems, to understand the ground reality of the British rule. Later, he participated actively in politics. He entered into politics in the year 1919. So by then, when Gandhiji entered into politics, the Congress phase has been changed off from moderate phase, extremist phase, to Gandhian era. So from the entry of Gandhi into the Congress party and taking over the leadership, we have the Gandhian era till India gets its independence in 1947. So the phase, which was the extreme phase of India's struggle for her independence, is during the Gandhian era in the Congress party. So now we shall first try to understand what are the ideals of Gandhiji, and then we can focus on the movements which were initiated by Mahatma Gandhiji. Now let us discuss, how did the ideal of Satyagraha come to India? As we just now recalled that Gandhiji fought the mass agitation in South Africa against the racist policies which are followed in South Africa. So the idea of Satyagraha Satya means truth. Agraha means power. So Satya Agraha, Satya's power. When you are fighting for say truth, you need not need to be violent. This is what the novelistic idea which Mahatma Gandhi has expressed for most of the Indians, and he want all the Indians to follow this one. In order to cultivate this attitude to the people, to not to go for violent methods, but to restrict themselves to be peacefully and do their agitation in a non-violent method, where they can fight if the cause was genuine and if they are fighting for the cause of the truth, definitely they can achieve the success. This is a message what Gandhiji want to give to the masses. But before appealing to the masses, he want to show it practically to all the people. So he visited some places to make them to experience how can the mass agitation also be done by being peaceful ways, by using peaceful methods, by being non-violent. So first of all, he visited the village of Champaran in 1916. After visiting the village of Champaran in 1916, then he decided, he expressed their grievances. People expressed their grievances to Mahatma Gandhiji, where Gandhiji fought for them with the ideology of Satyagraha. Later on, after this, he went to the Kedam in Gujarat in 1918. When Gandhiji went to Kedah in 1918, there the people were suffering with the plague disease, where they could not pay their taxes. They were completely worried how to pay back the taxes. So Gandhiji fought for them with the same ideology of Satyagraha. And later on, in 1919, Gandhiji went to Ahmedabad to the cotton mill workers. Where their wages are being reduced by their employer. So Gandhiji fought there also in a non-violent method and solved the problem of cotton mill workers. So in this way, Gandhiji propagated the ideology of non-violent method and Satyagraha. Satya means truth. So when you are fighting for truth and justice, you need not be violent. You can be calm, peaceful, and you can get your argument be clear. That's the novelistic ideology which Gandhiji has advocated to the masses of India and also the masses of South Africa. Where in South Africa he was very successful, same as with Indian masses also. He was able to convince many number of people. And finally, Gandhiji decided to have the civil disobedience movement on April 6, 1919. So, the civil disobedience movement was started. So the civil disobedience movement was started, and he was with the ideology that he want all the people to come back in a peaceful method to fight against them. They organized rallies. The rallies are being organized. People started to protest. Rallies and peaceful assemblies. So when Gandhiji gave the call of civil disobedience movement, there were many rallies which are being organized, and Gandhiji also asked the people to show their anger in a peaceful way and do not conform yourself to move on to the violent methods. So he decided to go on with pure non-violent methods. And when the rallies and peaceful assemblies are being organized, so from April 6th, the momentum went on. April 7th, April 10th. So on April 11th, the people gathered at Jallianwala Bagh, where they were ready to discuss about the issues which are happening. And why Gandhiji has gone to the civil disobedience movement is because of the Minto Morley Reforms Acts, the 1919 Acts, which clearly states that they can arrest anyone. The Britishers will have a right to arrest any individual whoever is found guilty according to their laws. And there is no certain kind of exemption for anybody. They can arrest anybody and keep them in the imprisonment, and there are no chance of meeting a lawyer also. So in this way, they have brought certain cruel or brutal laws to, you know, to curb the momentum of nationalism in India. So Gandhiji was fed up with the attitude of the Britishers, and he started the civil disobedience movement in order to ask them to change the existing laws. Even though the provincial assemblies did not approve this one, the ministers did not approve this one, but still they went ahead by passing this bill by the British Parliament. So when these bills were passed, Gandhiji was very much upset, and when this civil disobedience movement was started on April 6th, the people gathered in thousands and thousands in number. They started to do rallies, they started to burn the all the movements which they don't like for example banning all the non-Swadeshi goods, using only the Swadeshi goods. These all things started to make them to understand the clear picture of how much anger does the people have on them, and they started to give back the awards, honors, degrees, all the things what were being honored by the British government to them. And when this process in momentum at the Jallianwala Bagh, when they gathered, the General O'Dyer asked them to close all the doors of the venue and started to fire from the opening door, which was a very tragic incident which happened in the Indian history under the British rule. So in this, thousands of people were being wounded and hundreds of people passed away. With this brutal action all over the India, the anger rose for the people, and Gandhiji also was very much upset with the attitude of the Britishers. When the British authorities were approached to have an action on the military or this police department, the Britishers also started to terrorize the people. Britishers also want to use these kind of methods to make the people to get scared and afraid and stop the momentum. So Gandhiji felt very bad. During this time only, in 1921, in Turkey, the Britishers did not recognize the authority of Khalifa. Khalifa is the religious head of the Muslims. So Gandhiji wants, first of all Hindus and Muslims to join together. All should be called only under the name of Indians, not on the base of their religion. So Hindus and Muslims. So he wants to join together. So Gandhiji extended his support for the Khalifa movement. So why they are not recognizing Khalifa? So he started the non-Khilafat movement. So this Khilafat movement was actually initiated to bring Hindus and Muslims together, that whoever is in trouble, all will be participating and try to solve the problem. So Gandhiji and Shaukat Ali together started the movement of Khilafat to recognize Khalifa as the religious head of the Muslims and give him certain special privileges by the Britishers. So these all things were the initial process of Gandhiji's efforts and the ideology of Satyagraha. So the nationalism in India was a theme what we were discussing before also. So how did the nationalism got into progress? So when we talk about the nationalism in India, we discussed about the role of Mahatma Gandhiji, arrival to India. From where did he come? He came from South Africa. If you understand the momentum of Mahatma Gandhiji carefully, it is very easy for us to understand the Indian national movement also. As I told you before, the classification of Indian national momentum has been classified into three major periods on the basis of the Congress Party's rule. Congress Party was intended to form the actual struggle for Indian independence. So the base platform for Indian freedom momentum is Congress. So the Congress had again three phases. The moderates, extremists, and Gandhian era. So the moderates, extremists, and the Gandhian era reveal for us that there are three different phases in the Congress struggle to attain its independence. So as we discussed already elaborately about this one, so we shall not focus on the basis and the foundation of the three phases of Congress. So when we move on to the Indian nationalism, let us take the role of First World War, Khalifa movement. And Gandhi, Gandhiji's Satyagraha. So now, the First World War has been started from 1914 to 1918. Prior to this, we also have the Congress Party fighting for its independence. And before this one, way back in 1857 also, Indians have always try to show their dissatisfaction towards the British rule by the First War of Independence, that is in 1857. So the process went on like this. So with the outbreak of the World War I, Britishers need a strong army. And as you all know, where a group of nations together were fought the World War I, we need huge army to be deployed at various places. So in this context, the Britishers used to force the villagers to join the army. The forced recruitments were being in progress during the First World War time. Forced recruitments. The word forced recruitments means there you don't have any choice. You are forced to do certain things by the colonial masters. So the forced recruitments were being kept, and the many villages were suffering with severe famine and droughts because of the lack of the proper agricultural plan, lack of rains. And these all movements also raised the anger towards the British rule. And during this time only, the Turkey, which was under the control of the Britishers, did not accept Khalifa, the religious head of the Muslims. So Gandhiji's intention was to bring all the Hindus and Muslims together, first of all, and then we can fight against the Britishers. If you are not fighting against the Britishers in a united manner, it is very difficult to defeat them. This was a basic ideology of Mahatma Gandhi in this regard. So, when Gandhiji first of all came to India in 1915, as soon as he came to India, he did not enter into politics. He made a tour all over India. He went to Bihar, to the Champaran, where he saw the struggles of the villages, peasants. Then he went to Ahmedabad. Then he went to various other places. And finally, in 1918, he was in the momentum to establish the fight against the Britishers. So he joined with the movement of Khalifa movement. But before that, prior to this, he has observed the Rowlatt Act. The Rowlatt Act. The Rowlatt Act is considered as a cruel joke on the Indian democracy or on the Britishers' rule. Because we can't call it as an Indian democracy because India did not get its independence by that time. Only for name's sake, we have been given the representation in the elective councils or the election councils. So the Britishers, even though the imperial houses or the provincial states rejected the laws, the Britishers in a hurry manner have brought a new law. According to this law, they can arrest anybody and put him in the prison for 2 years without any reason. So this kind of clear laws have been made to curb the national momentum which is getting raised up in India. So Gandhiji was completely fed up with the moves of the Britishers. On April 6th, Gandhiji showed his dissatisfaction. He want all the people to do the non-cooperation movement. Why he want the non-cooperation movement or the civil disobedience movement? Initially, he want the civil disobedience movement to be organized first. The civil disobedience movement is something where we can show our disobedience towards the Britishers by not going into the schools, not cooperating with them, giving back all the titles which are given for us by the Britishers. In the same way, most of the people who are in the government schools, government which are run by the British government, left out them. Works, offices, everything they have left out. His intention was to show the anger in a peaceful way. Why Gandhiji preferred only a peaceful manner? His philosophy is peace and non-violence. He want to go with the weapon of Satyagraha. Satya means truth, the power of the truth, the agraha, the strength to search. When you are fighting for truth, you need not be violent. The truth itself will be victorious always. So he want all the masses to understand this philosophy and fight in a peaceful manner, but be very passive towards violence and be very active towards truth. His intention is very clear because he already proved this one very successful in South Africa, where he fought against the racial discrimination. After these all have been passed, Gandhiji gave a call to the nation that we all need to be together and we all need to fight for this one. So finally, on April 6th, Gandhiji was very much unhappy with the laws which were passed. So the days passed on. April 6th, many were picked up. April 7th, April 8th. On April 10th, many of the local leaders in Punjab were being picked up on this law, based on this law. So on April 13th, a huge gathering gathered in a peaceful assembly at the Jallianwala Bagh incident. So the newly charge taken by General Dyer, he took over the charge as in charge of the superintendent, and he want to terrorize the people and he want to make the people too afraid that there should not be any gathering gathered like this further. So he closed the doors and he ordered the police, his commanders, to shoot them, and many hundreds of people were injured and many hundreds of people were shot dead on that moment, which raised a severe anger for all the people in all corners of India. With this, in all villages, in all corners of India, the dissatisfaction has been moved on. The people started to attack the police stations, attack the post offices, destroy all the governmental properties, destroy the railway networks, and all these things initiated the process of anger of the people. So this Jallianwala Bagh incident has created a lot of terror in the different corners of India. Let us see in which villages, what are the major reactions that happened. The government, on the reactions of Jallianwala Bagh incident, people started to attack the government offices, destroy the government properties and all. Government also came up with a very repressive policies. Government started to attack all the people who are satyagrahis, who are doing their agitations peacefully, but now government want to suppress all the revolts very seriously. Before moving on to the villages where the revolts have been stepped up and towns where the revolts have been initiated, but you know, to understand why the people of towns and villages also understood that there is something seriously going wrong. That is the thing, is all the satyagrahas were brutally bent down and they were forced to rub their noses on the streets, and they were beaten up very crucially, very hardly. So all these things made Gandhiji to think on the lines of agitation, where there was a confusion whether we have to go for the civil disobedience movement or the non-cooperation movement. If we go for civil disobedience movement, completely disobeying the movement, that would be too early for the people. So he decided to go for non-cooperation movement. But at the same time, he also want to unite all the Hindus and Muslims. As we already discussed that in Turkey, the Khalifa is not been recognized. So all the Muslims started the movement called Khilafat. So Gandhiji joined with Shaukat Ali and started the movement of non-cooperation movement along with Khilafat movement. So these two movements were brought together and the process was being initiated, and this made the people to join, and this momentum has given a strength for all the Indians in all corners of India, and this influence has made people to stand against the Britishers, and people used to respond very strongly to the British rule, saying that the British Raj is going to come to an end and Gandhi Raj is going to come on very soon. So let us now see where are the different corners of India where the Gandhian influence has been made the people to break their regular barriers against the British rule. So the non-cooperation movement and the Khilafat movement, don't get confused with the movements. The first movement which was initiated by Mahatma Gandhiji on a large scale was the non-cooperation movement, which was started in 1921 January. Along with the non-cooperation movement, in order to get the Muslims also together and make the Britishers to afraid that all Indians are united, so it is very difficult to control them. Automatically, Britishers would decide to give freedom for the Indians. This is a base plan of Mahatma Gandhiji. So he joined the non-cooperation movement with the Khilafat movement in January 1921. So the first movement which was started by Mahatma Gandhiji is the non-cooperation movements. Many of the students get confused with the non-cooperation movement and the civil disobedience movement. The second movement which was started by Mahatma Gandhiji is civil disobedience movement. So the first movement on a larger scale was the non-cooperation movement. So Gandhiji started non-cooperation movement with the Muslims, getting them aligned together with the Khilafat movement against the Khalifa. Khalifa is not being recognized by the Britishers. He is not being given the recognition, authority or special place because he is the religious head of Islam communities. So now moving on to the context of non-cooperation movement. What does the non-cooperation movement do? In the non-cooperation movement, it is not the movement of only one section of people. The non-cooperation movement gathered all people from all corners of the society. Men, women, higher class, lower class, middle class, educated, uneducated, teachers, students, lecturers, who are studying in the colleges, government schools, working in the government offices, lawyers, peons, those who are being titled by the British government also surrendered their titles back, and people started to showcase their protest. So the sections of the people, the main people who have contributed are the middle class people, and all schools, colleges, lawyers, teachers, students, all boycotted the government function. The non-cooperation literally means that not to cooperate with the government. Gandhiji's ideology behind this one was to bring non-cooperation to force the Britishers to accept the demands of the Indians. Initially, when Gandhiji suggested this non-cooperation movement with the title of Swaraj, the Congress party itself has different views. The Congress party, some people were in the favor of the momentum, while others want complete freedom or Purna Swaraj. So Gandhiji deliberately discussed with them and told them that initial process should be done like this, and altogether only we can do something. If we break up the party and if we do it differently, the effect will be very less and it will be very easy for the Britishers to control this moment. So Gandhiji's words convinced most of the leaders. The alternative was brought up. The non-cooperative movement was started and it went on to very huge level with a grand success. People from all corners of the society and all corners of the country got motivated with this one. And not only the colleges, schools, teachers, post offices, courts, lawyers in the courts, judges, police stations. So not only one section, different categories, different sections of people participated, different professionals participated, all were motivated towards the freedom struggle. So what they want is they want completely freedom. And not only this, they banned all the foreign goods. The foreign goods are completely being banned. The foreign goods are brought outside and made as bonfires. And though the Swadeshi goods, the khadi cloth, is being costly also, people started to use all the Swadeshi products rather than using the Videshi products. And because of this, the trade, initially it used to be nearly 102 crore rupees. In 1921-22, it came down to 57 crore rupees. It was a drastic loss for the Britishers. So this impact started to fall on the economy of the British also. So slowly, the anger of the people has been experienced by the Britishers. So the Britishers are trying their level best to control the momentum at various places. They want to terrorize the people to stop the momentum. They used various methods. They used various forces to control the people. But finally, are they able to control the people? How did the people react for the Britishers? The momentum of non-cooperation, how did it spread at the various towns we have seen? Now, the rebellion, how did people revolt in the countryside? The national momentum start to spread to various corners into the depth of the country, length and breadth. So the people started to understand it as a momentum to raise their anger against the Britishers, to showcase their dissatisfaction against the Britishers. So as the time came, the people, the peasants in Awadh
are led by Baba Ramchandra. The peasants in Awadh are led by Baba Ramchandra, who was actually an intended labor, a forced labor who was sent to Fiji in the earlier period, who returned back safely, and he started the momentum, who was now basically a sannyasi, who motivated all the peasants to fight against the Britishers. So when he motivated all the peasants' problems were very huge in number. The landlords, the merchants, the talukadars used to force the peasants to work at them at very less cost or no cost, known as a system of beggar. So the beggar was forced by many peasants to work by the merchants, the talukdars. So they used to get huge profits while these people were forced to work for no income. This kind of things made the people to become day by day poorer and poorer. Those who were having a small piece of land also were forced to pay unnecessary taxes and unknown taxes actually for them under the different names. And these people used to pay them, they used to use their whole lands for the talukdars or the merchants or the existing landlords. So as the momentum went on, in June 1920, Jawaharlal Nehru visited the villages of Awadh. While he was moving on actively in the politics, he wanted to understand the actual problems of the peasants. So he went into the deeper parts of the villages and he understood by the ground reality what are the basic problems of the villagers. After understanding this one, they have set up peasant organizations, which is not initially accepted by the Congress, but Jawaharlal Nehru was very much concerned with the problems, and Baba Ramchandra and Jawaharlal Nehru together started the leadership with few others, the peasantry movements. In these peasantry movements, the farmers used to attack all the merchants, all the talukdars. When the non-cooperation movement has stretched on to all over, Gandhiji's words are being misinterpreted by the farmers. They understood that Gandhiji told there is no need to pay any taxes. Gandhiji's words misunderstood. Why we say it is misunderstood is Gandhiji clearly told that he is against the ways of the Britishers' laws and the taxes, but he never said no taxes. And the other thing is, Gandhiji never said that he is going to redistribute the lands for the poor, or he never used the word peasantry at all in any of his moments. But the people, the farmers in the villages, understood that Gandhiji told for us no taxes, so we would not pay any taxes. They went and attacked the houses of the talukdars, they went and attacked the houses of the merchants, they destroyed their palaces, they occupied their lands, and they redistributed the lands for the landless poor by forceful methods, by violent methods. This is how where Gandhiji felt very much upset with the ideology of the villagers, because the actual words of Gandhiji have been completely misunderstood by the people of Awadh. And not only this, there was a rebellious momentum which has happened in Andhra Pradesh. That is, happened at the hills of Gudem Hills, in Andhra Pradesh, where the colonial country, or the British's colonial government, decided to close all the forest. When the colonial government decided to close all the forest, the tribals, those who are living on the forest only, those who consider the forest as their motherland, those who know only to cut the crops or to do business only with the forest, things like collecting the fruits, collecting the honey, and bringing it to the city and selling it. So collecting the various leaves and doing business with this one. So other than this, they don't know anything. So if this is being enforced, if the Britishers are going to close all the forests and the entry of the people has been restricted, it is going to be a life threat for the people of the tribal community. So they need some alternative for this one. And at the same time, Britishers forced the tribal community people to work as a beggar for laying down the roads. So they were also forced for beggar to lay down the roads. During this time, the leader of the tribal community is Alluri Sitaramaraju. Alluri Sitaramaraju emerged as the leader. People initially used to believe that he had some special powers. He had some inclination to the incarnation, and he used to heal people even if they were been booted with the bullets, even if they have been hit with the bullets or arrows. He also used to say the revelations like future tense, what would be his predictions, and most of his predictions are almost true many of times. And people started to believe him that he is having some special powers. He is having some connection with the God. He is one of the avatars of the God. Like that, the tribal people started to praise him and got well connected with him. Sitaramaraju, who was basically influenced by the non-cooperation movement of Gandhiji, also praised about Gandhiji and told that Gandhiji's ideologies are very good and excellent. But in order to get independence for us, in order to fight the Britishers, the best way is to use the violent methods to destroy the police stations, to attack the police stations and to kill the British officials. That's what the message he spread to the people in the Gudem villages, and the tribal people used to attack the police stations and kill the British officials. Like this, he terrorized the people in the Andhra region, especially near the Gudem region. But after a certain period, in 1924, Ramaraju was being captured and he was executed publicly. But still, the inspiration has lived a lot. This is how the momentum of non-cooperation, which Gandhiji initially wanted to have a very peaceful moment, but later on, stage by stage, it started to become violent and more violent. So let's see what happened for this in the plantation regions. How did the non-cooperation movement has been taken by the workers in the plantations? Swaraj in plantations. The non-cooperation movement, Swaraj in plantations, is another side. We discussed before this that how the momentum has been taken up in the towns, later on by the peasants and the villages. As the time passed on, now we are moving on to a very far off place in the northeast. It would be really that we can appreciate the momentum spread to a very large region actually, because during those times we don't have any fast rapid movies or channels to communicate the information. It's only through the radios and the newspapers the information has to be passed off. But the Gandhiji has been an inspiring person not only in some parts of North India but the entire India. So now when we discuss the Swaraj in plantations, the actual meaning of the word Swaraj has been taken as freedom by the people, those who are working as in the plantations. So for them, freedom means to move freely. And you may get a doubt. So what is the great difference here? Moving freely is obviously allowed everywhere. The people, those who are working in the plantations, do not have any freedom to move freely. They are not allowed to move out of the plantation. Very rarely they are being given permission to move out of the working plantations. That is a very difficult task. Means they were forced to work whole along the month, whole along the year. That is the working condition here. This is according to the Inland Immigrants Law of 1859. So according to this law or this act, the people, those who are working in a plantation, are not at all allowed to go outside. Very rarely they are being given permission to move out of the plantation. Even if they try to ask permissions also, they are being denied. But as soon as they heard the Gandhiji's non-cooperation movement of Swaraj concept, they all people betrayed their rulers. They all people showed their anger and decided that we can now go freely to whatever place we want. And they also misunderstood that according to Gandhi's philosophy, they are going to give lands for the landless poor people in their own respective villages. so we need not stay here. So they all started to move out freely without listening to anybody. They moved outside completely. They started headed towards their own villages. In their way, the railway has been in strike, the steamer workers are being in strike. So in all places, as people are showing their non-cooperation movement, the peasant workers, those who are working in the Assam plantations, could not move outside of the places. So finally, the police people entered there and they were beaten up brutally. This is the fact which has been happened. But the actual meaning of a non-cooperation movement, which was not being defined by the Congress, went on to very untold faces. The people in the north understood it differently, the peasants understood it differently, the tribals understood differently. In the south, Andhra people understood it to be violent methods, and in the northeastern part, people understood they are going to get freedom. So Gandhi Raj is going to come for us, the British Raj is going to end up for them. So these all inclinations, these all changes, the actual motto of Gandhiji was to move on with a peaceful and non-violent methods. But all people in all works went on going on to somehow the other way into a violent means, because they were not being guided properly, it is not been described properly, it is not been explained properly by the Congress party. However, Congress was not happy with how the movement has been went on. So in this moment, or in this context of Gandhiji initiating the process of non-cooperation movement, we have discussed how the Gandhiji has stepped in to the Indian politics. How did he go reach to all corners of people by moving to Bihar, by moving to Ahmedabad, by moving to various other places and solving their problems by doing the Satyagraha agitation and making the people to understand what is Satyagraha, the power of the truth. Then you need not be violent. Automatically the power of the truth will make you to be victorious. This ideology made the people to understand it very clearly. But during that time only we have the Khilafat movement raised by the Muslims. So Gandhiji want to bring Hindus and Muslims under the same umbrella. So he started the non-cooperation movement plus Khilafat movement in Jan 1921. After he started the movement, it went on to different stages. Even Gandhiji could not able to control this one, because the words of Gandhiji have been misunderstood by different people at different levels. It was, let us take the example of peasants in Awadh. They destroyed the houses of the merchants, they destroyed the house of the landlords, they destroyed the house of the talukdars, and they have made them to be in trouble. Sometimes they even killed them also. When we come to the Godem people in Andhra region, where they understood that the militant action only is required, we need to blast the police officials, we need to kill the British officials. This is how the people in south understood. When we went on to the northeast in Assam, where the people are working in the plantations, there the people understood that they got complete freedom. So Gandhiji told us not to follow any rules of the British Raj. So Gandhi Raj is going to come. So we will move out of the plantations. We will not work under any of the British officials. Land will be redistributed for the landless poor people in their own villages. So they started to head it towards their own houses. This is how the momentum has got changed the entire shape to another shape. But the interesting fact is, let us take the peasants of Awadh or the Godem people or the workers in the plantations. All use the word Swatantra Bharat, all want freedom, all were connected with the ideology of one nation, Indians. This is how the momentum created oneness among all sections of people.
If you like this video, please give a thumbs up. Please subscribe to our channel to get more videos on CBSE syllabus.